life that we lead, the following of Jesus, this journey that we're on, has a series of ups and downs. Sometimes the tempter comes toward us and we feel a temptation and we're able to reject that temptation and be obedient to God, and we feel really good about our lives, really good about what the Lord is doing in our time. But other times we fail through temptation and we fall, we make mistakes and we sin, and we're kind of down because of that. And we walk out of the room feeling, oh, how can I possibly have ever done that? What happened to me? Who am I now? All those kind of things that we kind of struggle with and we wrestle with. And sometimes there are good days that we feel good about it, and then days that we don't feel so good because we have failed our Lord and Savior. So let me ask you, men, especially those of you who are married, how did you do this past week? It was Valentine's Day. Some of you are going, oh! It was Valentine's Day, and how many of you men would say, you know what, I did well this Valentine's Day. Raise your hand right here. You got some hands all over? I really ought to be asking the lady folks, couldn't I? Instead of asking the men, because they're going, yeah, I did really good. But the ladies go, no. Is there a man out there today who would admit that they didn't do so well this year in Valentine's Day? Anybody? All right. We got here. Okay. Here, out there. I'm going to help make up for that. I'll tell you what. Come here. Can I get a runner, Justin? This man right there, said he didn't do so well. So we're going to pass out some candy and give to his wife there, because that'll make all things better, because he's got some chocolate. So there we go. So now give that to her. Give it to her. No, don't keep it. Give it to her. Not for you, it's for her. And so does that make it better? See, there we go, right there. It was good. Because chocolate solves everything. Now, normally, in my family situation with my wife, I don't normally do so well on Valentine's Day, because our anniversary is at the first of the month. So our anniversary is early in the month, and then you've got to turn right around, and within about 9 or 10 days, come up with something else. And that's usually a struggle for me. But this year, for some reason, I was on the ball game this year. I don't know what happened to me, but this is our 19th anniversary this year of our marriage. And so the night before the anniversary date, I had a single red rose that I brought home from work. See, that's nice, right? And then the next morning, when she gets in her car, I've got an 18 roses right there attached to the steering wheel, so that when she got in that next morning, she'll tell the 19. That's pretty good, right? That's good. And then we found this chocolate store that in Springfield that brings the beans over themselves. They make all the chocolate, do it all the kind of stuff. So I bought some chocolate there, so that was really good. And then for Valentine's, I'm thinking, man, how am I going to top that? Because that was really good. Use a lot of energy and effort and did all that. And so I decided that I would do the chocolate thing, because that was a winner, right? So if chocolate wins, we're going to play that card again, right? Because this is like a really good, expensive chocolate, like the $9 a chocolate bar kind of chocolate kind of idea. So that was good. But then I also decided I would get real creative. And so I decided, if we'll work on this, that I would have this made, and I presented this to her on Valentine's Day. If we can go to the other slide there. I presented this to her, and this is like a personalized frame that's got Neil and Kendra. And then over there, you can't really see it, but it says, "Grow old with me, the best is yet to come." That's good right there, right? That's good, yeah, yeah. If you're 16, that's not so good, all right? But if you're my age, put that on there. And then I put the picture there for my children are like, "Dad, why'd you put those people's pictures in there? Who are they?" And I'm like, "What's going on? That's us." No, that's not y'all. But that's us, like one of the wedding shower, reception, or whatever, one of those kind of things. And I give it to my wife, and I got my 1 point. If you remember men's fraternity, when you mess up, man, you lose. Every time you make mistakes, like you lose 10,000 points, right? And then when you do something right, you get 1 point. Doesn't matter what it is. You know, you buy a diamond ring, 1 point. You take out the trash, 1 point. It doesn't matter what it is. You just get 1 point, and every time you make a mistake, you lose 10,000 points. And so I got some points on this because it was personalized, because she recognized you just can't go to Walmart, right? You just can't go to Walmart and find a Neil and Kendra frame. You just can't. And so she said, "Man, that is so thoughtful, that is so personalized," and I got my 1 point, all right? So I've got that point. I've already lost it a couple of times, but I did, at least on that day, get 1 point. And the reason I show you that is because I think that the church oftentimes makes the same mistake. You see, on this time, Kendra knows that I love her. Whether or not I get a frame, a cheesy frame that says both of her names on it, she knows that I love her either way. If I'd have gone to Walmart and just got a regular spray and got a pen and I scratched in there some kind of, you know, our name or scratched in something encouraging or something like that, she knows that I love her either way. But somehow, with that personalized spray, she feels that love differently. She knows that I love her the same either way, but she feels it differently because it's individualized and it's personalized. Well, I think sometimes the church makes the same mistake when it comes to somebody who does not know God, because we sometimes think, well, hey, we've got a church building. And hey, we've got the information listed on the sign out there. We've got it in the newspaper. That should be enough for people to feel our love. But the scriptures teach that our calling is not an institutional calling. Our calling is not just to proclaim the message indiscriminately, aimed at no one, but the message is supposed to reside in the hearts of individuals. And the more that you and I can communicate individually with people who are not following Jesus, the more likely they are to feel the love of God when we take the time to, instead of just broadcasting the message, we spend time individually sharing the gospel one-on-one in small groups and in other environments. And that's why the definition that I've been using the last couple of weeks has been so important, because the church is not really an institution. The church ultimately is a mission-focused movement. And a movement means that everybody is involved, and that it comes from the bottom up. It's a grassroots movement. It's not just institutional. It's not just making decisions in the big settings. It really is individual going to individual. And in the North American church, at least, I think sometimes we fail to recognize the importance and the value of one person who is convinced sharing with another person who is not convinced. That doesn't mean we don't have a great church and we shouldn't do all the great things we do and have a life center and all those kind of things. I think that Mark Strong was sharing with me something like 76% of the people who are members of the life center are not members of the First Baptist Church. And that's a wonderful way to reach out into the community. But if we're not spending time talking individually with people, then we're missing out on this movement of God-forgiven, Holy Spirit-possessed people who witness to the world concerning Jesus. That's our calling. It is not just to gather and worship, though that's important. It's not just to get together and do big things in the community and do the bashes and the events. And we're going to keep doing those. We're going to have a few more of those come on. We're working on one for the spring that's kind of new for us. We're working on all those kind of things. It takes both, but unless we are individually sharing the gospel with people, unless you and I are sitting down across a table having coffee or having a conversation and literally sharing the power of Jesus' life in another person's life, then this movement is going to be in trouble as time moves forward. Because it is the individual conversation that makes all the difference in the world. Now you go, wait a minute. We've already talked about the beginning of the church. And on that first day, in Acts chapter 2, we're in the book of Acts today. We're going to be in Acts chapter 16, borrowing some material from Andy Stanley in this series about church. But in Acts chapter 2, 3,000 people came to know Jesus in that first day. You remember that? And you look at that, and it was at Peter's preaching that was response. Well, if you will go back and look and see, you also know that before Peter preached, the 120 went into the community and shared the gospel and preached to people in their own language. If you go back and do the research, there's over 15 different countries, 15 different nationalities represented within that first couple of chapters in that passage. And those people individually heard the message in their own language in a way that they understood. And then Peter got up, and then he proclaims the message to the large gathering around him, and then 3,000 people come to know him. And so the challenge for us today, the challenge for you, the challenge for me, is not just to be good church members, to attend church regularly and cheer on the work of the church, but to actually individually and personally share the gospel with someone who has not heard the message. Not only is it more effective, and it is,
but it is also biblical. We've got your Bibles. We're in Acts chapter 16. We've been kind of following along on this journey, and last week, Jeremy did a great job preaching. He did an amazing job last week. I'm so glad to have Jeremy on the team, and Mark Miller, another one of our great speakers on our team. It's good to see those old guys in their 30s doing a great job of ministry. And so I love having them around, and they're doing a great job, and you're going to hear from those guys more often, I'm sure. But I'm excited about where he led us, because in Acts chapter 15, this message is beginning to get a little complicated. And as he shared with you, this message that was centrally located, that was local in a sense, ends up going global, and that all of these people, particularly the Gentiles, with a different background, a different language sometimes, a different culture, different experience, are becoming followers of Jesus and demonstrating the same power that the Jews have. And so there's this big issue of who gets in, who gets to be a believer in his circumcision going to be a line that has to be crossed for them to be true believers. Are we going to have to do that? And ultimately the message was that they got together and said, you know what? What we need to do is not to make it hard, not to trouble those who are trying to follow Jesus. We don't need to make the barrier so difficult and put a line out there that you've got to cross this and do that before you're in. He basically boils it down and says, don't offend the Jews and to abstain from sexual immorality. So if you do those two things, you are to really disadvantage yourself. And Jeremy had this great message and great point about the need for us to disadvantage ourselves for those who have not heard the gospel and those who are coming to it. And that applies to us today, that we as a congregation need to disadvantage ourselves so that others can enter into what's going on here. And so they have that agreement, and so then they go out and they start another series of journeys. It really becomes what often is called the second missionary journey. But what's interesting about that, there's some disagreement on who's qualified to go. It's kind of funny how you look at the scriptures, because the scriptures are made up of real people just like you and me. And they had this big disagreement over whether the Gentiles are in or not, and then they can't decide who's going to go on the trip, because Paul and Barnabas had a disagreement on who ought to go, and so they decide to go their separate ways and continue to do ministry, and everything gets benefited, and everyone gets benefited, which just proves to us, it proves to me again, that when we disagree, the best thing to do when we disagree is to come together, have conversation, love each other through that, and then if we can't do it exactly the same way together, then we can still work together for the gospel, even though we might have to go our separate ways. So that's exactly what happens. So Paul and Barnabas are going on this mission, this second missionary journey, and they want to go into northern Asia. They want to leave from where they're going, Antioch, and kind of come around. They'll have the maps for you. You get the maps in the back of your Bible, I'm sure. And so they're wanting to go north, but the Holy Spirit prevents them from going north. You remember this. And then one night, Paul has this dream, and we often call that the Macedonian call, because there is in this dream a man from Macedonia who says to Paul, hey, come over here and preach to us. Remember this, right? Those of you who got Bibles and read the Bible. So that's what happens in Acts chapter 16. So they go into the city. They fell from Troas, and they go into the city, into this area of Philippi. And when they're in Philippi, there are not enough people to have a synagogue in this particular Roman province. Because now they kind of left the Asian continent, and this is the first time the gospel message that we are aware of gets into Europe. It moves across that little water bridge, and so they go over into Europe, and they're looking for a synagogue to preach in, because Paul oftentimes goes to a gathering of Jewish people to preach the gospel message, because it was the fulfillment of the Jewish Old Testament. This is what's coming. And yet when he goes to Philippi, guess what? He can't find a synagogue. In fact, a synagogue, you had to have 10 Jewish males in order to form a congregation, a synagogue. But apparently, in this particular city, which is really a very important city, very, very important in the Roman Empire, a province, and so it had some special perks, special benefits, but when he goes to the city, there's not a synagogue. There's not a place to preach. There's no one to hear the message. And so they decide to go down by the river, which would be a place that God fears would gather. And he goes there, and then the scripture talks about what happens, because he runs into this woman who the scriptures say is a woman named Lydia, and this is in verse 14. One who heard, as he's preaching this message, one who heard us is a woman named Lydia from the city of Thyatira. So let's just stop there for a couple of seconds. The word Thyatira, have you ever heard of that particular city? Anybody know that city? Where have you heard that city in the Bible? Okay, thank you for paying attention to church all these years. Anybody know the name Thyatira and where you hear it from? in the book of the Revelation is actually one of the seven churches, right? Somebody want to check that while we wait on you? Somebody want to check on that? Look at them. You trust me or you want to check on it? Okay, you trust me. Okay, just checking. See if you want to trust me or not. It's one of those seven cities. The name Lydia may be a proper name, but it's also the name of the province where Thyatira is. So this may be her name, or it could be just the title of her, but she's from this particular city, happens to be in Philippi, and what she does for a living is she sells purple. Okay? You didn't know purple was something you could sell. Well, it really was, because in this time, the dyes and the colors were very, very expensive. You and I can go to the store, and we can buy anything in any particular color, and it doesn't really matter. Well, in those days, as you know, they couldn't just go to Strathmore and buy a particular color. What they had to do is they had to make it. And purple was very, very expensive. It's really only found really in two places. Sometimes you could get it out of a plant, the roots of a plant, and it would produce this purple-like dye. Or then there's also in that particular region of Thyatira and the community of Lydia, that province, there were these shellfish. And these shellfish, if you squish them hard enough, they turn purple. And so, just like most of us do. And so you could extract that purple color, and you could dye clothing. And so it was very expensive to do this. This woman probably was very wealthy because she dealt in that particular material. And purple, as you know, is a royal color because in those days, only those people who had a lot of money, typically those of the government who took your money, they were able to afford purple because the common folk couldn't do that. So here's a woman of influence, a woman of some means, a woman of power, and they go into this area, to this place where there's no church. They just start preaching open air in this area where the God-fearers, the people would gather, probably Jewish people, others that were not Jewish would gather, and they were a people who were there. And so Paul goes to that area, can't find a synagogue, not one there, not enough people, comes in, begins to proclaim the message, and this woman, one of the women who hears, by the way, very interesting, I think the first response to this gospel message in Europe comes from a woman. Interesting to me. I think very interesting how God kind of confuses what the culture says sometimes, because in the culture, that's not what you would do, but that's what happened here. And so this woman is a seller of purple goods, and she is a worshiper of God, meaning that she has some understanding that the Jewish God is correct, or the God that Israel worships is somebody that should be seen, somebody that should be heard. So, the scripture goes on to say, the Lord opened her heart to pay attention to what was said by Paul. She gets baptized and becomes the first convert to Christianity in all of Europe. And afterwards, she was baptized in her household as well. So here's what I want you to see. There are people that will respond to the message no matter where you go. No synagogue that's there preaching the Jewish faith, remember. There's not enough men to have a synagogue, but there is somebody who is following God, and when the message comes, the Lord sovereignly opens up her heart to pay attention to what Paul says and becomes the first convert. No church there, no preaching, none of those things. And she responds to the gospel and says, this is the greatest thing that's ever been happened, and she becomes baptized into her whole household, and she invites everybody to come back to her house so Paul can continue to teach her. Well, as you read through the rest of Scripture, something kind of strange happens on the way, right? There's another woman who's there, and she is a woman who is possessed of the devil or demons of some type called a Pythian spirit, which Pythian or Python was a snake that was at Delphi, and Delphi was the oracle where you went. If you were a pagan, didn't know what to do, you go to the oracles of Delphi, and you'd get a message of what is supposed to be, kind of like the card readers of today. Well, that's the kind of spirit that this woman apparently had. And she just keeps following Paul and around and saying, these guys are from the Most High God. These guys are from the Most High God. And finally, Paul gets enough of this on the way to Lydia's house, the woman called Lydia, and he just turns around and says, for that demon to get out of her, can you imagine this kind of opening into the city that's happening? And so Paul says that, and the people who own her become frustrated with Paul because now their key to success, their key to money, their key to future is now ruined by Paul. So they throw a big fuss, they throw a big fight, and so what happens to Paul and his crew is they get beaten again and get thrown into the inner city jail, the inner jail, because of all the trouble that's going on. So, Paul and Barnabas, they're in there, and you remember what happens to them? I'm talking a lot today of remembering, because I'm trying to move us through this passage today, but do you remember what happens when they're beaten in jail? They're not sitting around saying, why do bad things happen to good people? They're not in there complaining and fussing and saying, I'm going back on the boat. What do? They start singing. They start worshiping and praising. And whether there's other prisoners there or not, we're not really told. But they, we assume that there are, because Paul says later that, hey, we're all here. So they begin to praise, they begin to worship, they begin to sing. And you remember what happens then? Either their singing is really so bad that it vibrates the walls that close them, probably not. But the Lord hears them, and the walls fall down because of this praise and this worship. The place is shaken. And then the soldier comes in who's guarding them, sees that the walls are falling down. You know what happens with the prisoners when the walls fall down? You know what happens then? They leave, right? And so he takes his sword out and is about to kill himself, because that's what happened. Happened to the guys who were watching Peter earlier in the book of Acts. But what does Paul say to him? Paul said, hey, don't do yourself any harm. We're all here. And then that one particular guy is amazed. He goes in with the light, brings them out. I don't know if there's rubble all over them or how that works. I don't understand. But he goes in there and he asks them this question. This is the soldier who asks them the question. I know it's a lot of things, but stay with me. He goes in and says, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Now, isn't that interesting? That Paul has received this message to come to Macedonia. He goes in and finds a synagogue, probably frustrated about that, runs into a woman who believes, runs into another woman who doesn't believe, casts the demon out of her, gets thrown in jail because of the ruckus, and now there's a guy who asks him, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And here's what they said. They said, believe in the Lord Jesus. Doesn't mean you got to, pass the new member's class and before you can get saved. Doesn't mean that you got to walk the aisle. Doesn't mean you got to do any of those kind of things. But what you have to do is to believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. And they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. And he took them at the same hour of the night and washed his wounds, took care of them. And he was baptized at once, he and all his family. And then he brought them up into his house, set food before them, and then listen to this. And he rejoiced along with his entire household that he had believed in God. What does that mean for us? Well, when I look at this passage, it means that the gospel moves person to person. There's no real indication other than these two households that anybody else believed in Philippi. Paul didn't set up and have this great big tent revival meeting. Nothing wrong with a tent revival meeting. I think it's great. He didn't gather a group of people within the church. He goes individually, and individual people respond. Notice how they respond. The first person responds because the Lord opened that person's heart. Just opened it up. There's no other explanation of that. There's nothing that's going on. Paul seemingly didn't do any miracles. He didn't do any beautiful illustrations. He just preached the message, and her heart was open. The second guy, the first man apparently is saved, that's not those in the household of Lydia. The second one is saved not because of the heart has been opened, but he sees something pretty miraculous, right? He sees walls falling down. He sees prisoners who have a chance to escape, not escaping. And he goes into that and asks a question. What does that mean for us today? Well, very simply, I think it means that we have a calling on our lives individually to share the message with individual people. And when we do that, some people are going to respond. And it's going to have absolutely nothing to do with you other than you bringing the message. There are going to be some people that you begin to share the gospel with, and it's going to be as if the Lord opens their hearts supernaturally, sovereignly, and so they respond to the message, and you go, well, I'm not even sure I'm doing this right. Is this the right verse? Is this the right passage? Wait a minute, you can't do that yet. You've got to come to the church and walk through, and you're going to go, what's going on here? And it's going to be the power of the Holy Spirit moving in the life of that person. And all you've got to be there is the one who's turning the pages and the one who's sharing the message with them. That's all you've got to do. Other times, people are going to respond based partially on the way that you respond to the things that are going on around you. I don't want you to miss out. But oftentimes, our reactions speak louder than our actions. And there are sometimes, in the way that we respond to our circumstances and to our difficulties, that God is going to use those, and a person will come and say, you know what? There's something different about you. I want to know how I can have, sirs, what must I do? How can I have what you have? So what's the calling for us? Well, here's our action steps for today. Here's what I want you to believe. Here's what I want you to act on. I want you to recognize that if the movement of the gospel is to continue, it's not going to be because we gather in big buildings together and sing songs and listen to messages. That's not how it's going to work. It's going to work one-on-one, individually, as individuals share the gospel message with other individuals. Yes, we need the church. Yes, we need preaching. Yes, we need the life center. Yes, we need the baptist. But what really makes the difference is when one person maybe open up their home, one person taking somebody to coffee, one person doing something, and literally sharing the gospel with another individual. Here's what I'm going to ask you to do. I'm going to ask you, as a part of this series, to identify somebody in your circle, somebody within your sphere of influence, somebody that you know, and identify them as, you know what, that's a person that the gospel needs to get to. That is a person that somebody needs to share because either their life is not right, or maybe their life is right, but they don't know Jesus. And so you are going to identify somebody, this is a challenge for all of us, to identify somebody that doesn't know the gospel. And then what I'm going to ask you to do, and this is not original with me for Stuart, but I want you to invest in that relationship. I want you to begin to think about that person, and obviously when you invest in someone, you pray for them. Because I want you to pray for that individual, and I want you to think about ways that you can be an encouragement to that individual, ways that you can do something that would be positive in that person's life, and continue to invest and invest and invest in them, and then at some point, invite them into a relationship with Jesus. Invite them to know the name of Jesus. Invite them to come to church if that's what you want to do, but to really identify, to invest and invite. Now, why is that so important? It's so important because if we don't do that, if the church doesn't do that, if church people who believe in Jesus don't do that, there is no one else on the earth who are commissioned and tasked to do that. Nobody else is given that thing. There's lots of people designed to take care of people when it comes to food. Lots of people designed to take people with benevolence. But we're the only people who are called of God to share the message of the gospel. And for this movement to continue, it's not going to be about broadcasting, it's going to be about narrowcasting. I don't know if you know this, but when you're online and you're searching for something, everyone's watching what you're searching for. You know that, right? And so if you're Googling something, Google goes, they're looking for that. And I don't know if you notice, but on the sides, they start sending messages to you related to what you were searching for. So let's say you're searching for a new car. As you begin to enter search items and you're looking for new cars, guess what starts popping up on the side? All these advertisements for cars. Why? Because people know that if you're searching for cars, there's odds on that you might be looking for cars, and so advertisers pay big bucks to put that little ad by there because they know that you're looking. And more with our smartphones and all the other devices that we have, they are sending more and more narrowcasting messages to us. It's not just put a billboard up. It's a particular message to a particular person at a particular time. That is growing and growing and growing, and if you don't know they're doing that to you, you are oblivious to what's happening within the world. And they're doing it. Why? Because it's successful. And the more that it's successful, the more that people are going to do that. And this is why I just look back and go, this is funny. Because finally, the world is catching up to the gospel message in the church because the church has always known that. God has always known that particular message, that personalized, individualized message that God has given you to share with an individual, a person out there who is real, that will beat a million flyers every single day of the week. It'll beat a million radio spots. You taking the gospel and identifying somebody, investing in them, and inviting them to Jesus, that is so much more effective than billboards and churches and all those kind of things that just set up buildings and y'all come. It is so much more effective to do that, and our world finally recognized that, and we are the first ones to do that because Paul goes under the influence of the Holy Spirit to a particular region, to a particular place where a particular woman's going to respond. As far as we know, may have been the beginning and the foundation of that one of the seven churches in the book of the Revelation because the gospel message got to her individual. So don't quit doing what we're doing, all these things. But let me ask you a question. It's a question for your small group tonight. And when you read the questions, if you'll get it, if you get into your small group, you'll read this question. It's a very powerful question I've taken in my mind, and that is this. If you were the only person with the gospel message, would it die with you? If the whole movement was placed upon your shoulders or placed upon your small group shoulders, you're the only ones out there, you're the only ones that have the message, would the message end with your group? Would the message end with you? It's nice to send a little frame and Neil and Kim's, I got a point for that, remember? How much more important that we take the gospel message and we personalize it for the people in our sphere, people within our school, people within our business, people within our families, that we might share the gospel message, that we might share the name that's above every other name with an individual. That's the way the scriptures teach. That's what Paul did. And we'll discover in the verses later that they changed the world. In fact, the scriptures say that these turned the world upside down. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? I know you, and I know that you want to be something, a part of something bigger than yourself. I know that you want something to last beyond you. And I thank you for the support that you do this church and all the wonderful activities, and you're going to help us out in the Refresh Conference, and you help us out the Bashes, and I'm thankful you work so hard, and so thank you, thank you, thank you. Those are very important to what we do, but the most important thing that you could ever possibly do is to share the good news and share the name of Jesus with someone who needs to hear it that is within your circle, that is within your sphere of influence, because the message is not always just for everybody. The message is individualized, personalized for one individual. And that individual that God may be calling, they may want to open their heart, might come as a result of you sharing the message. And there are others who are watching you and they see how you're living or difficult times or difficult circumstances and they really want to know. And they may come to you and ask, or maybe they won't. But either way, you have a message to proclaim individually, yourself. And we all stand in front of our God with that message, and we'll be asked, what did you do with what you were given? My hope and prayer for us is that our answer is not just, hey, we're part of a great church, though we were, and not that we did some great events, but that we individually personalized the gospel message and shared it with individuals, that they have come to know you, Father, because of us. So, Father, I ask that you might help us to do that, that you would help us as individuals to identify people in our lives who need the gospel message. Maybe they've never heard it. Maybe they've heard it 100 times. And Father, you're calling us to invest in them. That at some point, the right moment, that we might invite them into relationship with you. Father, help us to do that. Let the movement not die with us because we kept the message to ourselves. But Father, we freely gave that message to those around us. Father, help us to do those things in strange and dark times, terrifying times. Father, help us to do that for the sake and the glory of our King and for the benefit of humanity. Thank you, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet. I'm going to ask you to respond to this message. Maybe you can respond right where you are. No, you don't have to come down front. Nothing magical about that. But maybe the Lord's put a burden in your life and your heart saying, you know what, I need to respond to that message, and I'm going to do that. I'm going to identify. I'm going to invest. I'm going to invite. If we would all do that this week, we would see Branson turned upside down. So may we be faithful. I know so many of you do this, and you're an encouragement to my heart. But if you're not doing that, would you start this week? Maybe you don't know this Jesus we've talked about. Maybe you need to repent and believe this morning. Maybe you need to join the congregation. There's something else you want to talk about. Whatever it is, would you respond as we stand together and as we stand.